Now we're going to see how the laws of motion and energy apply to gravity and orbits. A good way to think about what we'll be doing here is to look at this picture. This is the International Space Station in orbit around the Earth. The space station travels at 8 kilometers per second, going around the Earth every hour and a half. It's been doing this for many years now. But look closely. The space station is a spindly contraption with lots of pieces sticking out every which way. There is no way you could put a rocket on this and give it any significant push. It would simply fall apart. So how does something like this go racing around the Earth at this tremendous speed for years on end? That's one of the big questions we'll be looking at in this section. We'll start by looking at the force of gravity and learn how it behaves. Next, we'll see how we can use force to understand what an orbit is. Finally, we'll see how gravity can produce tides and why this is important for astronomy. Let's try it by dropping a soccer ball and a truck and see what happens. As you can see, they hit the ground at the same time. In fact, all bodies on Earth are pulled towards the ground with the same acceleration, 9.8 meters per second squared, no matter how heavy they are. However, objects that are very lightweight or have a large surface area, like a piece of paper or a feather, will be slowed down by friction with the air. If you take away the air, they fall just as fast as a rock. This is a general rule about gravity. Everything on the surface of a given world will be pulled down with the same acceleration. That acceleration will be different for each world, though. For example, on the moon, the acceleration is less, so things fall more slowly there. You can click on a link to see this being demonstrated by the folks on the Apollo 15 mission to the moon back in 1971. In the 1600s, Isaac Newton figured out the law of universal gravity. I could just give you the formula here, but I think you should get a chance to see how Newton came up with this equation. It's not that difficult to see where most of the parts come from. The first step is to start with a basic observation. Everything feels the pull of gravity. In other words, the gravitational force acts on all matter. However, think for a minute about Newton's third law of motion. For every force, there is an equal and opposite reaction force. So if every bit of matter feels gravity, then every bit of matter must also have its own gravitational force. That's why we call this the universal law of gravity. It's universal because all matter exerts a gravitational pull. Planets, moons, stars, buildings, people, guinea pigs, and so on. We all have our own gravity. So now let's figure out how strong this force is. We'll call the force of gravity F sub G, F for force, and G for gravity. So we can start by saying that the gravitational force is equal to something, we're just not sure what. If everything experiences a gravitational pull, try holding a ball close to your head, and then let it go and see what happens. Of course, the ball will be pulled to the ground, not to your head. So why is that? Right, the Earth is a lot bigger than your head is. This means that the gravitational pull must depend on how big something is, or more accurately, how much mass it has. So we can say that the gravitational force the ball feels depends on the mass of the thing pulling on it. Let's write this out as gravitational force equals something times m sub 1. Next, think about what we just said about falling bodies. Everything falls with the same acceleration. Imagine that instead of dropping a truck and a soccer ball, you are trying to push them instead. You know from Newton's second law that if you want to push the truck, it takes a lot more force than it does to push the soccer ball, because the truck has a lot more mass. That must be what's happening with gravity. If a giant truck gets the same acceleration as a ball, then the truck must feel a much larger gravitational force than the ball. If it were the same force, the ball would race toward the ground, while the truck would just sit there, floating in midair, hardly moving downward at all. So the force depends on the mass of the thing being pulled as well as the mass of the thing pulling. We can write this down by saying that the force is equal to something times mass 1 times mass 2. Let's think about that ball again. We know that when we drop a ball, it falls to the ground. Now, the planet Jupiter is 300 times as big as the Earth. But somehow, even when Jupiter is high in the sky, we never have to worry about the ball falling towards Jupiter instead of down to the ground. Why is that? Of course, Jupiter is far away, so gravity must get weaker as objects get farther apart. We can write this by saying that the force is equal to something times the two masses and divided by the distance. Note that this is distance, not diameter. But what distance? Is it the distance between the surface of the ball and the surface of the Earth? Try this experiment. Set the ball on the ground. At this point, the distance between the surface of the ball and the ground is zero. If you put a distance of zero into the formula we've got, you'll find that whatever masses are there no longer matter, because the force blows up to infinity and the ball should be stuck to the ground forever. Since you can pick the ball up off the ground, the distance in the formula can't be between the surfaces. In fact, the distance we need is between the centers of the objects. If you want to know the force between the ball and the Earth, you use the distance between the center of the ball and the center of the Earth. Since the Earth is much bigger than the ball, this will usually be simply the radius of the Earth. We've almost got the law of universal gravity. There are just two more things we need to do. First, when we actually calculate how the force behaves, it turns out that it gets weaker with distance even faster than what we have here. In fact, it drops off with the distance squared instead of just the distance. Secondly, we need to put something in there to get the units right. We've got force units on one side of the equation, and we've got mass squared divided by distance squared on the other side. They need to match up, so we put in something called the gravitational constant, capital G. We'll look at this more closely on the next slide. That's Newton's universal law of gravity. The force of gravity between any two bodies depends on both of their masses and the distance between them squared. Let's look a little more closely at the gravitational constant. First off, it's a universal constant. The gravitational constant is the same on the Earth as on the Moon and anywhere else in the universe. Its value is 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 meters cubed per second squared kilograms. So anytime you see this in a formula, you know what you'll have to put in. You don't have to memorize the value, though. I'll give it to you on exams. As I said on the last page, this constant makes the units match up. This is the part that tells you how much force you get from 1 kilogram masses at 1 meter distance. At the same time, this forces you to use certain units. Anytime you see the gravitational constant in a formula, you know that all the rest of the units in the formula need to match up with this. So masses have to be in kilograms, distances in meters, and times in seconds. If any of the values you are given are in different units, you'll have to convert them before you can calculate, or you will get the wrong answer. Finally, let's think about what the gravitational constant actually means. That negative exponent tells you that the constant is small, meaning that the force of gravity must be incredibly weak. In fact, it's the weakest force we know of in the universe, much weaker than the other force we experience regularly, the electromagnetic force. To appreciate this, think about standing up. The gravity of the entire Earth, 6 times 10 to the 24 kilograms of it, is trying to drag you into the ground. However, just a few kilos of bone are able to resist the pull of the entire Earth and hold you up. Those bones get their strength from the electromagnetic forces in the atoms. So gravity is weak. The only reason we notice it is simply that it adds up. There isn't any negative gravity. So the gravity of the entire Earth can combine to pull on you all at once. On the other hand, electric forces come in positive and negative charges. So most of the time, they cancel each other out.
There's one last thing about the law of gravity that we want to point out before we go on, and that's a philosophical point about scientific method. Notice how Newton worked. He based his three laws of motion on observation of the world around him. He developed his law of gravity by assuming that the laws of motion applied to parts of the universe that were beyond his ability to observe or measure. Above all, he was trying to develop a law of gravity with logical consistency. The force of gravity that an object feels should be the force that free fall acceleration indicates. This logical, consistent thinking is characteristic of the way scientific theories are developed. And this is one of the times in the course where we discuss all the steps in the process. So what is the next step in the scientific method? You should know that by now, but if you don't, go back and take a quick look at the science section. Or your instructor may assign a discussion of this question as a your turn. If so, you may also be asked to consider whether this is a step that Newton himself could take. Do you think it's a step that could have been taken in Newton's own lifetime?
Now let's have a look at an example of how to calculate the force of gravity. We'll figure out how much gravitational force we would feel if we were standing on the surface of the moon. This is our weight on the moon. Here's a picture showing what's going on. You're an astronaut standing on the moon. The things you'll need to know here are your mass, the mass of the moon, and the distance from the center of you to the center of the moon. This is effectively the moon's radius. So let's remind ourselves what needs to go into the gravity formula. We need the gravitational constant, which is always the same. We need the mass of the moon in kilograms. Since it's currently in Earth masses, we'll have to convert to kilograms. We need to have our mass in kilograms. And we need the distance from the center of us to the center of the moon. If we're standing on the moon, this will be the moon's radius in meters. Once again, we'll need to convert from Earth radii to meters. So let's take care of those unit conversions before we go on to calculate the force. For the mass of the moon, remember that one Earth mass is 6 times 10 to the 24 kilograms. So we multiply the mass of the moon, 0.012 Earth masses, by 6 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, divided by one Earth mass. And that gives us the mass of the moon in kilograms, 7.2 times 10 to the 22 kilograms. If you don't know your own mass in kilograms, you can always calculate this by taking your weight in pounds and dividing by 2.2. For example, someone who weighs 170 pounds has a mass of 73 kilograms. The radius of the moon works similarly to the way that the mass did. We know that one Earth radius is 6,400 kilometers. However, we want our answer in meters, not kilometers. So we remember that 1 kilometer is 1,000 meters. This gives us one Earth radius is 6,400 times 1,000 meters, which equals 6.4 times 10 to the 6th meters. So we take the moon's radius, 0.27 Earth radii, and multiply that by the conversion factor, 6.4 times 10 to the 6 meters, divided by 1 Earth radius. This gives us 1.7 times 10 to the 6th meters. This is a good place to do a sanity check. The moon may be smaller than the Earth, but it's still a world. You would expect a large number of meters, and the fact that we're getting millions of meters fits well here. One common mistake is to just assume that the mass and the radius are already in units of kilograms and meters. If you do that, you'll see that the mass is much less than a kilogram, and the radius is much less than a meter. In other words, you'd be saying the moon is about the size and weight of a volleyball. That's not going to give you a realistic answer. Now we can go ahead and do the calculation. As usual, we write down the formula. Then we put in all the values with their units, including the gravitational constant. This is a good place to check that we've got all the units right here. Make sure that the distances are all in meters, the masses are all in kilograms, and the times are all in seconds. And wherever you can, try to make sure that the values look realistic. Now we can go ahead and calculate the force. Just multiply through the numbers on the top and divide the result by the radius squared on the bottom. This gives 1.21 times 10 squared, or 121 newtons. Remember earlier we saw that we could calculate weight on Earth using Newton's second law of motion, W equals ma? If we do this calculation for someone with a mass of 73 kilograms, we find their weight is 715 newtons. So we'd weigh a lot less on the moon than on the Earth. This makes sense. Since the moon is a lot smaller than the Earth, its gravity is weaker and you weigh less on it. Now you can try working with this gravitational force law. Calculate your weight on this planet. There are several steps here, so you need to take it slow and make sure you write down what you need to do each step of the way. Remember to show your work and be careful of the units.
Remember this table? You should be using it to help you keep track of the equations we use in this course. Fill in the F equals G MM over D squared section of this table now. Keep it and update every time we use a new equation. You'll find this page useful doing homework and reviewing for exams. Depending on your section, you may be required to submit a copy of the completed version for credit.